Hey there, and welcome to Concierge Medicine Radio, your source for actionable advice and real stories of physicians running and growing concierge practices. For more interviews and notes on today's show, please visit conciergemedicineradio.com and enter your email. Now, let's join your host, Taylor Pearson.
Hello, hello. Welcome back to another episode of Concierge Medicine Radio. Thank you for joining us. We have on the show today Dr. James Pinkney from Diamond Physicians in Dallas, Texas. Dr. James is a board-certified family's physician and got his first taste of concierge medicine at Cedars-Sinai in Los Angeles for his residency. He has since moved back to Dallas and has built a practice from scratch. In a little over a year, he's gone from no patients to well over half full of his maximum capacity, which from other physicians I've talked to is a pretty impressive growth rate. In fact, that's faster than anyone I've talked to. So the way he was able to do that was he became and has become a featured expert in the local media in Dallas. He's a regular contributor on radio shows and TV shows, and has really gotten a lot of free press, but earned press, in terms of what he's had to do to follow up with reporters and get his practice featured. He's on a national commercial and, as I said, a pretty regular contributor on TV and radio shows, and has gotten a front page newspaper article. So he goes into some of the details about how he did that, how he was able to contact those reporters and follow up with them, and how much work that really takes. He also talks a little bit about Medicare and his experiences there. I know there's some questions. Talks about being able to opt your clinic out of Medicare while still working ER shifts. And then also talks about how he brings patients into his practice. So once someone calls him and says, I'm interested, at that point, what does he do to bring them into the practice and let them get to know the practice and have them become members if it's a good fit for them? He also goes into his biggest mistake, which was spending a lot of money unnecessarily on a website. So we talk a little bit about how to choose a good website design company, what you should look for, what to be aware of. And if that's a stage you're in, I'm happy to help out with that. That is my background. I've done websites for multi-million dollar e-commerce companies and small businesses and for friends and everything else. So if you have any questions about what's a fair price to pay, what do you need in a site, how does the process work, how long should it take, anything like that, feel free to drop me an email, and I'm happy to help out. But without any further ado, let's get on with the show. All right, welcome to the show, Dr. James. Tell us in a couple minutes a little bit about your background and how you got into concierge medicine and started Diamond Physicians.
Well, I'm a board-certified family medicine physician, and I actually grew up wanting to be a surgeon. So I received my medical degree from Baylor College of Medicine in Houston, and then I was accepted at Cedars-Sinai Surgical Program in L.A., and that's really where I got my first taste of concierge medicine. I was doing some post-surgical rounds on a celebrity patient at Cedars, and Cedars is completely different than any other hospital in the country. We're definitely told just to do what our celebrity patients ask. And it was about 11:30 at night, and the patient asked me to call their doctor. And I said, you know, it's almost midnight. Are you sure? And he said, absolutely. I want my physician to know exactly what's going on right now. So I gave the doc a call, and they were very gracious, gave them an update on the post-surgical issues, and that was my first taste of concierge medicine. And I said, wow, you know, this is amazing, but how can I make this service available for everyone and not just the super elite, the super wealthy? And that's when the wheels started turning, and I actually decided to switch from general surgery into family medicine specifically to start an affordable concierge practice, which is now known as direct medicine. That was 7 or 8 years ago.
So tell us about Diamond Physicians then. How did that all get started? That's your current practice in Dallas.
Exactly. So I actually moved back to Dallas, finished my training at Methodist in family medicine, and actually joined the American Academy of Private Physicians. I went to a few meetings and polled as many concierge doctors as I could. all of them told me, and I told them my idea. You know, I said I wanted to charge a monthly membership fee, and I wanted to make it affordable. And all of them told me, you know, you have to charge an annual fee. You have to get your money up front. And I said, yeah, you know, I understand cash flow, but I want to make this service available to the other 98% of the population. They all told me, all the concierge docs said, practice for 10 years, build up your census, then send out a letter and stating that if you don't pay me $5,000 to $10,000 a year, you have to find yourself another physician. You know, my moral compass just didn't align with that role. So I decided to start a concierge practice myself and did some more research and found out that there were actually other physicians across the country that shared my same sentiments. And once I knew that, there was no doubt that I was going to start my own direct medicine practice.
So you opened your doors in 2013, and we were chatting before this. So you've already had a lot of growth. You're over halfway full. And part of the reason I found you was very active on social media. You have a very active web presence. You know, went around to your website and poked around, and you've got a client testimonial videos. You've been on some radio shows and other national media. So I know one thing a lot of people struggle with is, for those that don't transition and do what you've done, is getting off the ground and getting to the point where the word of mouth can grow the clinic organically. So tell us a little bit about how you've been able to do that.
Yeah, the website and the national radio interviews and things of that nature definitely didn't come from right from the start. That's been a process for us. This is our fifth website platform.
Wow. In 18 months?
No, this actually started in 2010. So, you know, I'm a planner. So this process has been the last 4 or 5 years. So as I was planning this out, my first demo websites and my first website was actually back in 2010. And then as I got more momentum and got more funding, I was able to develop different websites. So going back that far, I actually had a lot of problems securing a loan. So financing was definitely an issue. I had a brilliant business plan. I actually went to 11 different banks and I got 11 no's. All of them loved the idea, but none of them wanted to put their money where their mouth was. So it wasn't until 2012 that I actually received financing. So I was funding the entire venture with my own personal funds until 2012. And once I received a loan from the bank, then things kicked into overdrive and we started to upgrade our website platform. And then we started the build out of our office space in the Park Cities in Dallas, Texas. And that's when the ball started rolling. And we realized that you really have to be able to become a medical expert in the local media. And that really was the key for us to achieve such, you know, explosive growth. So as we started trying to figure out, okay, what do we need to do to get clients in the door? We found that the more radio shows that I did, the more television appearances, things of that nature, there was a direct correlation with how many phone calls we're getting, how many website hits we were getting. So that's where we started spending our energy. And it's been extremely effective. I was able to secure a national Vistaprint commercial that actually highlighted the business. And that was a huge win for Diamond, because that spot plays multiple times a day all over the country, even in other countries. My brother was in Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, and said he saw the commercial down there. And I've also had responses from Jamaica. It's been a huge blessing for us, the national Vistaprint commercial, and then other things that we've been doing with radio presence and website.
Did the national commercial actually bring in a lot of patients? I know people that have gotten like big national media exposure and waited for the influx, and it's never really happened.
You know, it's been a steady flow.
Okay.
What it has done is drummed up a lot of interest. So I can't say that we've had a ton of conversions, because it is national, and mostly we do get a lot of calls from other cities, you know, asking about direct medicine and asking if there's a Diamond available. But the good news is, you know, we are a franchise. So I set this up as a franchise from the very beginning, knowing that my goal was to provide affordable health care for every U.S. citizen and to help other doctors wanting to get out of traditional primary care and find a niche that was more compatible with a high quality of life and giving the patients the quality care they deserve. So from that perspective, the Vistaprint commercial has done phenomenal.
There's almost a credibility, like you could point to that commercial and it gave you a lot of credibility to go onto other platforms. Okay.
And people call on me. I usually get 2 to 3 legitimate franchise requests per month. And that is with no advertising on our end. And the other great thing about the Vistaprint spot is that I didn't pay a dime, you know. And that's the biggest thing. There's no way that a small business could afford a tens of millions of dollar campaign. But because I was able to secure that, not using any of our marketing funds, it's just been an unbelievable experience.
So tell us how you got the Vistaprint commercial and then also how you got the local media. Because I know that's something a lot of physicians, they see the value in it. Like you want to be covered in the store, in the local newspaper, or the local magazine. But how do you negotiate that? How do you arrange those deals?
Right. Well, I actually have a acting background. So when I was in medical school, it was a hobby. I enjoyed acting. I did a Gatorade commercial. I did several sports commercials, and I did a national Walmart commercial, and I took acting lessons, and I took voiceover lessons as a hobby. And little did I know that would come into play a huge role in the success of this business 10 years later. But I've always been a commercial buff. I love commercials. And a couple of years ago, I saw a Vistaprint commercial, and I said, wow, that's an amazing marketing tactic. They use small businesses and promote the success of a small business to indirectly promote their product.
Right, they're doing case studies.
So when I saw that, I was like, man, Diamond needs to be on there. What a great way to market Diamond indirectly through Vistaprint. And I actually do use Vistaprint products, and I have been using them for years. So I sent them an email, nothing, called them, nothing, sent them several more emails, and finally they responded, and this was about a year ago, and put me in the pool, the applicant pool, to be interviewed. So once I was in the applicant pool, I went through a series of interviews and made it to the final rounds, and I think what really set Diamond apart was the Skype interview that I underwent. I actually gave the producers and the marketing team a tour of my office and kind of immersed them in the experience, because direct medicine, affordable concierge, whatever you want to call it, it's an experience, and it's very hard to articulate exactly what you get. So I took them through a virtual tour as if they were a client. So I started in the waiting room and I came out and greeted them, and then took them back to my office and sat, and we did a little short consultation and took them to the exam room, and then brought them back into my office just like I do a normal client. And they absolutely loved it. They loved it. And so do our clients. So I think that's what really stood out for them and made them choose Diamond to highlight as one of their small businesses in their business card campaign. So I shot the commercial. They flew me down to Austin, Texas. Yeah, I wasn't paid for it, and I didn't pay them. So I basically traded my time for a national TV spot, and I'll take that trade every day of the week.
Well, give us the same example. I mean, I think it would be awesome if we could get every direct pay doctor on national TV spots, but certainly local media. I've had a lot of people tell me that's effective. How are you able to get on those kinds of shows, the radio shows and the TV interviews?
Yeah, again, at first we were paying a lot of money to be on these shows, to be on the radio. And I noticed that, you know what? I was getting some feedback and some conversions, but it wasn't overwhelming. And we noticed that it was the jobs that I was locking down that weren't paying, that I wasn't paying for, were the better opportunities. So I'm not saying that advertising doesn't work and that paying for spots isn't appropriate at times, but if you can maximize your marketing dollars and also try and solicit different medium to pick you up, that's also effective. So I started sending out emails, making calls myself to different radio hosts, radio personalities, and I got some to bite. And the biggest one that I got to bite was Dallas Morning News. So I sent them emails for like 6 months, and I also sent emails to local reporters as well. And you have to be very careful. You don't want to be too pushy. Maybe one email every 2 or 3 weeks. Definitely don't want to email them every day. But eventually, I got feedback from Dallas Morning News. One of the head writers there that had been there for 20 years came out. They interviewed myself and my business partner, Dr. Lissy, and it was like a 3-hour interview. And she was hard-nosed, you know, real hardcore reporter. We had no idea if she even liked Diamond. And she also interviewed a few other concierge medical practices in the area. Well, the article came out December 17th, Saturday morning, front cover, top poll, Dallas Morning News, a million readers. And there we are, Diamond Physicians highlighted. And the 98% of the article was about us. And we were just blown away. You know, the phone started ringing off the hook. It was insane. So that experience, Dallas Morning News picking us up, was because I just sent an email and was persistent.
Well, you didn't send a email, I'm guessing. I'm guessing you sent 20 or 30 emails.
No, I sent multiple. Yeah, I sent several emails over 6 months. But I think the key there is persistence. So to all the physicians out there, you know, starting a direct medicine practice and trying to kick this thing off from the ground up, you just have to be persistent, but not too pushy. And it's a fine balance. And one of the things that's one of the things that we perfected over the last 2 years is figuring out, okay, how much do we push on a news reporter or a journalist until they get the story? Because this is newsworthy. Direct medicine is newsworthy. I still think we're the best kept secret in Dallas. We offer unbelievable services at an affordable rate, and the country really needs this service.
So take us down to a little more of the ground level. You said you've perfected that process. Like, what is that? You have you'll make a spreadsheet of local reporters, and then you're going to email them every 2 weeks with a new story idea until they finally call you, or how does that actually work?
I think, Taylor, that's our secret sauce. I don't know if I'm going to be able to.
That's the magic sauce?
Yeah. Well, give you all that, because we are a franchise, and the whole point of purchasing a franchise is to purchase a model that's proven and that someone has gone through different experiences and wasted a lot of money and made mistakes and now has kind of figured it out. But I will tell you this, more often than not, the best approach to local media is not paying for things.
It's just persistently following up with the reporters.
Right. You have to be persistent and you have to, because I've had experience with the media, it's a very tricky response, a give and pull. So you can't get frustrated. Sometimes you have to cut off communications for 3 months and then bring up the conversation again. So it's kind of hard to articulate exactly how to do it. It's just something that we've figured out.
Was there with the Dallas Morning News story, how long did it take you to arrange that deal?
From the time I started contacting them to the time the article was published, probably about 7 months.
And how many points of contact, like how many times did you touch base with the reporter before she came out to cover you?
Oh, just once. When she finally emailed me back,
okay,
she did the story.
But how many times did you email her?
Oh, I'd say 4 or 5 times.
Okay.
But I didn't just focus on that one reporter. I also emailed different editors, different levels of at the Dallas Morning News, different journalists. You don't want to keep hounding the same journalist, and you don't want to keep hounding the same point. You have to kind of switch up your story, because if you don't get an immediate response, it means that your story wasn't compelling enough to do a story at that point.
But let me transition into what you've done online. You've obviously been successful with local media. Is the online what lets you convert the local media into patients, or how do you use your web presence?
Well, the web presence is credibility. You want to put everything that you've done with local media online so that your local potential clients can see that and see that you're immersed in the community and that you are a viable option to deliver an exemplary product. So the way we've been able to leverage our web presence is by finding big name endorsements. And it's much easier said than done. But our biggest endorsement to date is Larry Brown. Larry Brown's a Hall of Fame NBA coach. And again, that was a deal that was about 4 years in the making. So back in 2010, I was doing some ER work, and I ended up taking care of an SMU basketball player. Well, that started an initial relationship with the head trainer. So from that point, the head trainer contacted me to take care of another basketball player that cut himself during practice. So I went up there and stitched him up. And then over the course of 3 years, we developed a relationship with SMU, or now official sponsors of SMU. And then Larry Brown came in 2 years ago, and then we signed him up as a client. So that was a phenomenal occurrence for Diamond, but again, it was 3 or 4 years in the making. And we didn't ask him to endorse us right off the bat. You know, he's been a client for over a year. And at that point, we felt like, okay, do you like our service? Would you be willing to tell everyone how much you enjoy our service and how much you love Diamond? And he said yes. So sometimes you have to be brave enough just to ask. But at the same time, you don't want to ask too soon when someone hasn't developed, you haven't developed enough rapport and that patient-physician relationship isn't strong enough to really elicit such a great endorsement. So that Larry Brown endorsement, when people see that, they're like, wow, okay, if Diamond is good enough for Larry Brown, I mean, it's definitely good enough for me. And I guess that's a product of pop culture and the way we look at celebrity and whatnot. But everyone at Diamond is treated the exact same.
Are you using any kind of paid advertising, or are you working with any kind of agencies to do marketing online, or is the web presence for you just a way to showcase the credibility you're building in the community?
Right now, we're not doing any advertising. We have done that in the past. But like I said, we've kind of figured out what works and what doesn't work and what time to use ads and when to pull back. So at this current time, we're not doing any paid advertising. All of our hits are generated through radio interviews, like the one I'm doing with you now. I've done a lot of radio interviews with Fox. I think I'm going to be on their business channel. Did a Skype interview on Tuesday, so that should be airing on Fox Business at some point. And then I'm on the Traders Network show here locally, and then any print media, any article that someone does for us that pushes people to the website. So all of our marketing efforts are to get people to the website to learn more about Diamond and then pick up the phone and call us.
And then you use the website to, they hear about you, so they hear you on the radio interview, they go to the website and you've got lots of educational material, how the practice works, examples of, you know, social proof, and then they pick up the phone.
Exactly. I think that social proof is a key word, especially when you're starting a practice from scratch. You know, if you aren't in the traditional model, you haven't established yourself in the community, so no one knows who you are. You may be a wonderful doctor, wonderful personality, charismatic, a great caregiver, but how do you articulate that? How do you translate all those qualities into something that's tangible? And the way we do that is through social proof, through all of the media outlets that pick us up and do stories on medical things. And a lot of times what we're talking about is not about our practice. And I think that's a key point as well. I think doctors want to promote their practice and talk about their practice, but sometimes just talk about what's going on in the world. I was on Fox the other day because of the Ebola scare. So I did a little segment on Fox 4 Dallas on Ebola and what it is. And that is just as potent as a piece directly on Diamond.
So what you're doing is you're building your credibility as a medical expert. And then when they want to have you as their medical expert, their physician, they're coming into the practice.
Exactly.
So when someone calls you after they've heard about you, are they usually like ready to join right away? Is it people call you once they get sick and then they want to join?
We have all the above. So sometimes people see, we've had cold calls from a Vistaprint commercial. Someone saw the Vistaprint commercial, which really isn't about what Diamond does. So there's four versions of the commercial, but none of them really highlight the fact that we are an affordable concierge or a direct medicine group. But some people will see the commercial, then go to the website and read more. But we've had clients that just call us and give us their credit card number. I'm signing up. I need this. I want this. I get it. And it's a smooth, great sale. Other times, they want to come in for a consultation. They don't completely understand it, but they're interested. And then sometimes they just want to know the price. How much does it cost? And we really try not to discuss price over the phone. We really like to get people in the office. So that's another piece of advice I'd like to give all the physicians listening, is you really want to get people in the office. Don't give them a lot of information over the phone. Get them in the office, because again, you're selling an experience. And it's hard to articulate what an experience, what direct medicine is to someone that has no idea of the benefits, or they think they know, but they really don't truly understand how incredible having a physician on call is 24 hours a day. So again, you're selling experience, and to sell an experience, you have to get someone in your office and prove to them the value.
So what do you do in that initial visit? Is that like a free consultation, or how do you handle it?
It's a complimentary consultation. Clients come in, we give them the red carpet treatment. They sit down in the physician's office for at least an hour. Sometimes we block an hour and a half, and we tell them all about our practice. And we tell them the benefits that they'll receive. We tell them about our Diamond 360 advanced physical exam and why it's the best physical exam on the planet. All the proactive things that we do at Diamond, and they love it. And then we give them a tour, and then they usually sign up then. If it's a husband and wife, you have to have both of them in the room. So potential client walks in your door, and they're married or they have a significant other, you have to have both of them in there. Very rarely do you close a deal where there's just one present. Very rarely. It's happened before, but usually you have to schedule a follow-up consultation and get both of them there. So just don't get discouraged if someone doesn't sign up immediately, because they will always want to discuss with their significant other. That's a 99% of the time.
So if you're going to bring them in, you ask them to bring their spouse in as well.
Absolutely.
Okay. Well, let me pivot here. And I know something else you know a fair amount about that people have questions about is Medicare. So you are opted out of Medicare. Is that right?
Yes, we opted out of Medicare. It's a very intricate and confusing process to try and bill cash for non-covered medical services and then also bill a government-sponsored insurance payer.
But you still have Medicare patients.
Yeah, we have clients that have Medicare.
So do you have any issues? I know this is just a specific question, and maybe you can riff on what it brings to mind. But, for example, Medicare Advantage members, are they still able to get their services covered and referrals and prior authorizations? Since I know Medicare Advantage is a little bit more like an HMO.
You know, we don't have any Medicare Advantage clients, but we do have some Affordable Care Act HMO clients, so I can comment on that specifically. For those clients, they have to go to their PCP that's assigned to them in order to get a referral. And we have tried and tried and tried. For instance, with Blue Cross Blue Shield, we had a client that had an Affordable Care Act Blue Cross Blue Shield Advantage plan, and I just wanted to send him to a general surgeon to have a lipoma removed in a difficult, challenging spot close to his spine. So I'm seeing him, he pays me, cash every month, and I just wanted to get a referral because I'm not on his card. They wouldn't do it. They would not accept it. And we tried for weeks until we finally gave up. So I'm sure that's probably the same case with a Medicare Advantage client. If you're not the PCP on that card, you are not going to be able to do prior authorizations and send referrals and whatnot.
They do have to go through the PCP. Okay.
Yeah. Well, I assume. Definitely with the Blue Cross Blue Shield Advantage HMO plans or any of the other ones on the exchange, I'm powerless when it comes to those sort of things.
And then you also do, you said to keep your skills sharp, sometimes you'll do ER shifts or urgent care shifts, but you can do those having opted out.
Yes, I still do ER shifts a couple of months. I enjoy the ER. I was a surgery resident, so I don't want to be at a level one trauma center, but I do like to do, suture repairs and lacerations and things of that nature. And you don't have as much volume in concierge medicine, so you don't get as many lacs and fun procedures to do. But it doesn't affect my practice because it's under a completely different NPI number and PTAN number. With the hospital that I work for, I'm credentialed under them, under their NPI number, not under Diamond Physician's NPI number. So yeah, my individual NPI number is the same, but for billing purposes, you bill through the facility NPI number.
Okay, so that was after you opted out, you went to the facility and they set you up with a different NPI number that you could bill to Medicare for?
Kind of. So basically, okay. Each NPI number for the facility can opt out. So what Diamond does has nothing to do with the hospital. So they can still bill Medicare and Medicaid for any client, any patients that come into the ER, and it has nothing to do with my private practice. They're two completely separate entities, and since, you know, really I never see those funds in Texas, Texas cannot employ, hospitals cannot employ physicians. So I don't know how it is in other states, but basically I'm contracted with a company called MCARE, and MCARE pays my salary and the hospital bills for the services. So I'm not like paid a percentage of those revenues. It's completely separate. But the same principles should still apply. It's a different PTAN number for each facility NPI. So really, physicians that are starting their practice, which I highly recommend, is to find a moonlighting position when you're first starting out, because you will have a dip in income if you're coming from traditional primary care, or if you're coming from the urgent care background where you're used to getting paid a salary or hospitalist or whatnot. You definitely want to have an ancillary source of income so that while your practice is building, you can have some money to take care of your family and even put towards the business if need be.
And is that something you've just kind of scaled down as Diamond has grown?
Exactly. Okay. Right. So when I was in 2011, I was doing two 24-hour shifts. Actually, I was doing three 24-hour shifts a week before I got my loan, and that was to fund all the things that I was doing. And as the practice grew, I scaled back the ER shifts. And that's what I recommend, because it's, you know, when you're used to making a certain amount of money and then you have a huge income dip, that can be a tough pill to swallow and something that needs to be anticipated.
And you were doing house calls before, is that right? So you're doing house calls in ER, and then after you got the funding, then you went and opened the clinic.
I wasn't really doing house calls. Okay. I owned a house call company.
Okay.
But I wasn't doing them myself. I had a geriatric house call company, and we serviced solely the geriatric population, so it was all Medicare, and then a few of them had a secondary insurance. But I learned a lot in that business, and you know, one of the reasons that I did sell that business and go into cash pay direct medicine was the reimbursement rates. Not only were they being slashed, but Medicare can go into session and then not pay you for 6 weeks. And when you've got an $80,000 payroll a month, yeah, you can get into a lot of trouble very quickly if you have accounts receivable. We had AR in 120 days in the rear. So it's a very problematic situation dealing with government payers. And I think a lot of people in traditional medicine understand that and realize that there's got to be a different way. And I believe direct medicine is the answer.
For Diamond, what would you say is the typical profile of your patients? Are there is there one specific profile, or are there like a couple key ones of that you see coming in?
Yeah, I get that question a lot. We are all over the spectrum with our client demographic. You know, I've got a 24-year-old kid who probably makes $20,000 a year. He's got type 1 diabetes, and he was tired of going to the county hospital every week and having a different doctor manage his insulin. So he pays me $95 a month, and I take care of his insulin. He gets it. And then we've got, you know, we got Larry Brown, who I don't know how much he's worth, but a lot. He's a Hall of Fame NBA coach, and I treat both of them the same. So we have the entire gamut. Now, we are in a fairly affluent area, actually a very affluent area in Dallas. We're located in Highland Park. So again, I would recommend starting a new direct medicine practice in a more affluent area if you can. Now, if you want to start the practice in a low-income area, I tip my hat to you. I want to do that as well. I do have some ideas, and we are starting a nonprofit called Shine Bright to reach the underserved community. But it's very hard to start a business with including people that don't have a lot of disposable income, no matter how great your product is. So I would recommend starting your practice in a more affluent area, because people with more disposable income are more willing to spend that money. But that doesn't mean that we don't have low-income clients, because we do. We take anybody and everybody that understands our concept and pays our monthly membership fee. And that literally ranges from, we got a family of five, two teachers. They can't make more than, I don't know, 80 grand a year.
Are most of them high utilizers of healthcare? Like, for example, the guy with diabetes, that kind of makes sense to me because certainly he needs the care.
That, again, is,
or
is
just very, all over.
Is variable as well.
Okay.
I've got very affluent clients that are extremely high utilizers, and I've got affluent clients that never call me and I can't get them in here. And the same thing with our clients that have a little bit less disposable income. So it just depends on the person. Never judge a book by their cover. Everybody that walks in here is given the same tour, the same speech, the same presentation, and that goes for sales in general. When you're selling a product, you never judge a book by their cover, because you never know.
So you have a defined process where you'll bring people in, you'll walk them through the clinic, and you really kind of let them get to know you that first visit.
Oh yeah. Everything is streamlined. There's a protocol for everything that we do. So again, you know, we are franchise model. So, you know, we want to be the MD VIP, the signature MD, of tomorrow. And because I knew that, we have streamlined all of our processes so that every client receives the same experience. And it goes down to as much detail as what their favorite drink is. So, you know, when the client comes in, if they like the green tea, then we'll have a green tea ready for them. And it doesn't cost us a lot of money, and it's something that's simple, and it's personalized, and it goes a long way. So there's different levels of direct medicine. I would put us more in the upper scale direct medicine. You know, our prices are pretty low. You know, we start at $45 a month for kids, and adults start at $95 a month. But I know people that charge $10 a month for kids. So we're not quite there, because we are in an affluent area, and rent is extremely high. So you have to really tailor your price points to what area you're in and what your fixed costs are for certain things. But I would love to provide services for $10 a month, you know, $10 to $50 a month. But in this area, we can't do that. But I do have plans down the line to create a structure that can support lower socioeconomic classes.
Are there any specific tools you're using in Diamond that you wouldn't have used in a traditional practice, whether that's software or business tools that you would recommend to other physicians? Like, you talked about keeping track of if their favorite drink is green tea. Where are you keeping track of that? Is that in your EMR? Or?
No, we have, you know, we have a profile. Yeah, it can be in the EMR. We have a profile of a client, and there's a note section, so we can write down little details of that in that section. But as far as tools, we definitely are cloud-based. I don't know if a lot of traditional practices are cloud-based. You don't want to have the liability of someone coming in when your office is closed and stealing your hard drives and having that client data on a hard drive. So we're cloud-based. We love technology. We've got flat screens all over the office, and I review all of my labs with the client on the flat screen. They love that. We utilize the iPad as much as possible and different mobile tablets. One of the biggest things that we use that I couldn't use in traditional practice because of the time commitment is our Diamond 360 Advanced Physical Exam, and it's basically the Bale-Doneen method. So I would recommend all the docs out there to study the Bale-Doneen method. It's wonderful with prevention, and we've tweaked it and put our own little twist on it and streamlined with our own protocols, but it's a wonderful heart attack and stroke prevention program that most traditional doctors would not have time to do. It takes us several hours to review our client's medical history, to compute and analyze all the labs and create a customized nutrition and fitness plan based on evidence-based clinical data for our clients. So that's a huge tool that I would definitely recommend people take, the Bale Doneen class, the preceptorship.
Well, we will put a link to that up on the site for anyone that wants to check it out, because I don't know much about that. I'd be interested in learning more too. Looking back, is there a mistake, something that stands out in your mind? If you could go back, what are the biggest mistakes? What would you recommend someone else getting in? How can they learn from your experience?
The biggest mistakes that we've made as far as the most costly would definitely be the website. You know, I don't have any background in computer science and computer programming, so I've learned so much over the last 3 years. So when you guys are out there, when the docs are out there picking your website platform, make sure you pick a template that you love, because it's the base, the foundation template that really is the building block for your website. You can't just change a font here and move something around there with these really complicated pliable mobile templates that can conform to the iPad and the iPhone and to the desktop. So I didn't know that. So when we started creating our first websites, I was like, yeah, I don't really like that. Can you change this? Can you change that? Well, it costs thousands of dollars to rewrite code and things of that nature to make very small changes. So pick a platform that you love, the whole website template, and then build around that, and it'll save you tens of thousands of dollars down the line.
So my background actually is websites, and I can strongly second that. So the difference, and one of the things you explained, is if you have to move elements around the page, that can be $5,000, $10,000, where if you just want to replace what that is, you want to change this out for, you know, this video for that video, that's fairly nominal.
That's exactly right. I know that firsthand now, and I just didn't know. So when you choose a website design consultant or company, make sure that they're doing the website design in-house and that they are not outsourcing to India. Because I hired a company that I thought he was doing the website changes, and he never told me. He made it appear that he was doing the changes, and he was outsourcing everything to India. And I was wondering why things were taking so long, and the things that I asked for weren't exactly right, and that's why, is because he was a mediator. So I was very upset about that. I spent a lot of money and had an inferior product that I actually scrapped. I didn't even use that version and went to another firm and started over again.
Yeah, generally the advice I give is, well, obviously work with someone you trust when people ask me about that, and then also just ask for past work. That's usually a pretty good indicator of future work. I've worked with outsourcers in other places, and it is hit or miss. I know some guys that do it and they're able to offer really good value because of it, and they have good teams, and then some guys that do have the exact same experience you have, whereas they can't control the quality and it ends up being a disaster. But yeah, and if anyone has any questions about that, I'd be happy to help. You can drop me an email or whatever. I do have certain platforms and stuff I would recommend. Do you use WordPress? Do you know?
We do use WordPress.
Okay, so that's generally what I would recommend for pretty much any small business.
I recommend WordPress as well, because someone with no computer science background, no programming background, can actually change the content in WordPress a lot easier than other platforms. So definitely recommend WordPress. You can go in there and change content. If you can change your mind about a slogan or something simple, I do all that stuff myself. So I only call the webmaster if I need something complex or something moved around or something changed. I don't have those skills, but I can change the title of a photo or the title of an image or add different content to a particular page.
And because of the flexibility, it lets you do a lot of customization that doesn't cost what you would think customization cost. So there are still elements, like Dr. James said, about moving elements around on the page can get expensive, but there's a lot of things you can do with WordPress that would have been, you know, I can build websites today for $4,000 that would have cost $40,000 5 years ago.
Right.
Dr. James, we appreciate your time. What are you working on that you'd like other people to know about?
I think the biggest thing that we're working on is the franchise component. You know, we really would love to help as many physicians out there that share the same dream and the same goal that I have, and that's just to provide exemplary care at an affordable price. So, yeah, I've made a ton of mistakes over the last 5 years, and I don't want others to make the same mistakes that I did and really spend a lot of money in places that you don't need to. So I think that's one of the benefits of choosing a franchise and getting help trying to achieve your dreams. You know, I'm really happy now. I found my niche. My quality of life has gone up tremendously. Direct medicine is such an unbelievable practice and a great concept, and it is the future of healthcare. So diamondphysicians.com, email me at drjames@diamondphysicians.com or follow me on Twitter at @the_drjames.
And he does like to tweet, so if you get on there, you'll hear plenty about him.
I will.
Dr. James, thank you for your time. Everyone else, thank you for joining us. We will be back with you next week.
All right. Thanks, Taylor.